say something, you say no.
Welcome back. It's still News Hub, and we still have Barrister Fred Nziako. Oh, I don't need to call him a lawyer again. He has already told us he's the learned man in the house. And we also have Alistair Wilcox. Yes, they've made the studio. The educated man. We are the educated. They are the learned. Yeah, we have them in the studio, still on the same discussion. And very soon, too, we'll be joined by our Port Harcourt studio. That's Edwin Jonathan, who is a public affairs analyst for this second topic. And what is the issue? We are looking at the tantrums, call it a tantrums, that was thrown by the president 2 days ago when he said that for about 10 years now, the National Assembly lawmakers have nothing to show for the 1 trillion naira spent on, allegedly spent on constituency project. And that brings us to that question again, constituency project. How constitutional is constituency project? Let me start with the lawyer. Over time, we've heard that that budget is an executive bill. We heard that it should be implemented by the executive. But now the president has said, from the ICPC report, that there is nothing to show.
The Nigerian political system is committing 2 major crimes against the people. The first crime is this crime of constituency project. I call it a crime because it is an economic crime. The second one is the crime this one that the executive commits, that they keep money and call it security vote as another avenue of stealing the people's money. The same hand that handles the issue of constituency project should handle the issue of security vote, because these are merely unconstitutional provisions. These are not in the interest of the people. These are massively unaccounted for, and these are not supposed to be. There is no reason why the executive should be taking an amount of money that we don't even know, and then they call it security vote. And in the midst of the security challenges, the natural question will be, where has the vote worked? And to what use have these security votes been put to? At the presidential level, at the gubernatorial level, at even local government level, the chairman of local government, even the administrators that were appointed by the governors, they take security vote. It's usually shared between the local government chairman, the DPO of the area, and some other strong heads in the area. They just collect the money and share it.
That sounds like a strong allegation.
No, but that is what it is. Lamide Adedibu told us.
Zika will talk to you because
Lamide Adedibu told the governor then that, look, go and bring out the security vote for us to share, because we are the ones who make
secure the state.
Who secure the state? If you don't bring it out, we make the state ungovernable. The governor thought it was a joke. The next day, there was riot in the marketplace. And then the governor called him. He was ambassador and the mediator then. And then there was peace in all your state. So that simply tells you, if he laid it bare, that simply tells you that that thing was to be cut off completely from our system. Let every money that comes into the system be adequately and duly accounted for. A former governor has told us, I think it was Richard Scholar, that in some states, security vote is as big as 2 billion every month. You now ask
and
yourself.
And unaccounted for. 100%
unaccounted for. And it does not even go through legislation. So if you begin to talk about that, I expect Mr. President to also look into that.
Okay.
That does not mean that I support the constituency project. I've always said that that is an aberration. So security vote, constituency projects are evil against Nigerian people.
But we know that, Alistair, constituency projects are projects that are supposed to enhance the state in terms of infrastructure and all of that. I've had a number of members of the National Assembly say that they have no direct contact with the monies for their constituency projects. So at what point did they start having access to it, so to speak? Because what they've always said to us continuously is that they only suggest the projects that are needed to be done in their constituencies. So do you think there is a point now at which they now have access to the funds?
There is back and forth on this matter. Back and forth. The closest I have gone to hear personally was Abike Dabiri when she was representing Ikorodu constituency. And he was the one that was, I think I heard him directly once, that they don't have access to the money. what they do is they don't even appoint a contractor, but when the contractor is appointed, what they do is to work with the contractor, determine the location, determine the project, and then when the contractor is appointed, they work with the contractor, they don't handle the money. But of course, you know, this is Nigeria. I take that with a pinch of salt. This is Nigeria, where, you know, in first instance, why would there be a constituency project? What is constituency project? If it's a constituency project, you, the legislature, should be the one that will initiate a project to say, as the time I was representing you, I did this and this. You can raise funds from anywhere. Because every money that is supposed to be expended, yes, you say it's passing through the budget system. Our budget system, again, is one hell of a problem. Before you make a budget, you should have had drawings and you should have conceived the project, know the cost of the project, have the, if it is a road, you have the design, you know the cost, and then you now bring it to the budget. Not working from the answer to the question, as this constituency project is, okay, let's give the assemblymen 100 billion for constituency project. They now begin to share. Okay, you could do, you are going to take 20 million. Whatever that will do for you, whatever that should do, you could do, that is your headache. Okay, Bonnie or my friends, Aguata's local government.
Njikoka,
local government. His representative will say, okay, let's give you 30 million. Okay, whatever that can do. In that case, what do you think that can do? So the president was right. Because if in the last 20 years, right?
10 years, 1 trillion.
That 1 trillion. My dear brother, do you know what it's called 1 trillion? If, assuming every constituency...
They said it went up to 40%. That's
okay, 1 trillion, that's 400 billion. Yeah. Assuming 400 billion was expended in micro projects.
Okay.
My brother, so the president will have seen that there was something unclear.
We are running against time, and time is really not on our side this morning. But we understand that they've established that network with Port Harcourt. We have Henry Peter Ekine, who is a lawyer, who also would have spoken to us about the first discussion we have, but it's also good to talk to us on this issue. Then we also have with him in the Port Harcourt studio, Edwin Jonathan, who is also a public affairs analyst. Gentlemen, we sincerely apologize for that delay before we get you on board for this discussion. But if you can do us a favor, just one response each, that would be okay for us. But let's look at the issue now. We're talking about this constituency project and the presidency has lashed out at them. Let me start with you, Henry. What do you make out of it? Our two guests here are on the same page over the issue of constituency project. But the Senate minority leader has come out to say that it's an indictment on the president because there are ministries who execute this project. It shouldn't be about the lawmakers. What do you make out of it?
Okay, thank you for the opportunity. And let me start with this before I make a comment on the previous discourse. I think I hold a view that our constitution is really very clear about the functions of the respective organs of government. The legislature, the National Assembly, of course, derived its legislative powers from Section 4 of the Constitution, which primarily is to make laws. And then, of course, Section 5 of the Constitution puts on the place of the executive at the federal level, led by the president, to execute or implement laws in this country. And to that extent, it also includes the execution of projects and also ensuring that the budget, which is the financial legislation for a year, and whatever projects or programs that are included in that budget are executed by the executive. So when we begin to hear issues about projects, then a reasonable mind would only place that on the desk of the executive. And then examine how those projects are either done or not done, or whatever would have happened to appropriations, funds that have been appropriated for those projects. Wherever those projects emanated, whether they were conceived by the legislature or a Nigerian, a citizen, or whoever, I think it ends on the desk of the executive to execute that. So with what we know about constituency projects and the explanations that have gone on is that members of the National Assembly or the legislators who are representatives of the people in some direct form would want to show a reflection of what representation they have of their constituents by saying, let us make an input or some suggestion of projects that can make impact in the areas we represent in our constituencies, and then they make those contributions. But I believe, and one would expect, that when it comes to the procurement processes for those projects that the legislators may have made contributions to finding their ways in the national budget, the procurement processes would still have to go through the executive. So if we have a thorough and comprehensive procurement process, then one would expect that even if there is a road project that was to be in my constituency and then was initiated or suggested into that budget by my representative, then the procurement process should take the normal procurement process for any project to be executed. And then the execution proper should be by the agencies of government that fall within the executive. So for the executive to turn around, and then probably probing the expenditures.
Mr. Henry, let's pause you there for a moment. We're actually out of time. Let's listen to Barrister Edwin Jonathan for a moment before we wrap up this segment.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, Edwin Jonathan, once again, welcome to the program. Yeah. Now, as this investigation has started, do you think there are measures that should be considered or should be adopted to ensure that it doesn't become a witch hunt to the opposition parties or opposition in the legislature?
Well, my first take is that I have always been against the so-called constituency project, because as somebody actually on your studio hinted, is that if it's my constituency project and I'm the one representing my constituency in that material particular, it means that although I may not be directly executing it, but I would have influence on how, on who executes it. And that's probably why the president came up to, say that so much has been frittered away through that system. Well, there's nothing wrong in probing the system, but I think that we have always, we are becoming a nation of government will soon do that, government is about to do that. I want us to make a transition from what we are about to do to what we are doing or what we have already done. We need institutions. And what I think is, if so much is committed to a project, there should be checks and balances. There should be an accounting system that naturally those who execute such projects should, respond to. What I mean is, just like you have suggested, so that it does not become a political witch hunt, there should be a structure that, like a clearinghouse. If my constituency project is not being executed properly or was not executed, somebody should answer for it. And if it's a member of the executive, why not? And we don't have to really make noise about it. Now, the National Assembly is responding as a body. It shouldn't be that way. ICPC, EFCC, and all the organs that we already have in place should just move in one after the other, look at the construction projects, look at for who and who is responsible, which contractor took what, and how much has been expended, and how to, and what stage is this project. It's not supposed to be a political issue, seriously. It's an administrative matter which the laws should be administered quietly, without noise, without media drama. But we're in a country where all we do is just govern on TV, govern on radio, govern on print media. We should be doing real governance. If an amount of money have been disbursed for a particular project in a particular constituency and it has not been executed, why not? The EFCC should move in and find out which contractor is involved, how much has been released, and what should have been delivered, and why it is not. So quietly.
Thank you very
much.
In
that way, we have a system
Thank
that
you very
naturally
much, Mr.
accounts
Edwin Jonathan.
For money.
Thank
that
you
have been
so much. Once again, we want to appreciate you for that patience. And it's a topic that we might still need to stay on, because the National Assembly members will also want to have their say on this issue, so that we don't, script their ear behind them. But we will get them to talk to us on this issue. Thank you for your time. Our time is really fast spent. We understand that you've been around for some time. Thank you, Henry Peter Ekine, for your time, the lawyer, and also Edwin Jonathan. Gentlemen, I'm happy that there is no conflict on this issue. You are on the same page.
No, and we're of Nigerians.
Yeah. And we're so sorry that we have to actually wrap up this segment, because
I think Nigerians support the president on this matter, because really and truly a lot of wastages goes okay. on in this country.
Thank All you right. so much.
Thank you, Barrister Fred Nzako, as well as Alistair Wilcox. Thank you for your time with us.
Many thanks for having me. Thank you.
All right, well, let's quickly take a break. And when we come back, we have another thing for you. Please stay with us.
Here, the controversy ends. Spill out the issues. State the facts. Deal with the fiction. On Head to Head, we say it just the way it is. No matter whose ox is gored. Incisive. Detailed. It is No Holds Barred. Head to Head is back. Bigger, better. Weekly on STV.
Say something, you say no.